Hello and welcome to A Healthy Mind. I'm Dr. Sislena Grocer-Ledbetter, Director of Counseling and Student Development at the University of the District of Columbia and your host. Today we're talking about the connection between spirituality, music, and mental health. And I've invited my husband, Todd Ledbetter, to talk to us about how to balance and the inevitable balance between spirituality and mental health. We're going to talk about the fine line between genius and insanity. So I'm glad you tuned in to watch. Todd, thank you for joining us on today.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, and there's been so much information about the link between mental health and music. And I'm so glad that you decided to join me because you've been playing music a long time. So tell everybody else how long you've been playing.
Well, I started playing the saxophone at age 10 in elementary school and been playing ever since.
So about, so you've been playing for 40 or 50 years. No, I'm just kidding.
Not quite that long.
No. But you've been playing a long time. And I think that, you know, we talked a little bit about all of the research linking mental illness to music and some of the positive effects. But there are also a lot of musicians who have dealt with some of the negative impact of mental health with music. So what are some of the musicians that may have influenced you?
Well, some of the musicians that influenced me, some of the people that I listen to and continue to listen to, are people like John Coltrane, Charlie Parker.
Just all the greats.
Yeah, all the greats.
And what people don't really know about them is that a lot of them struggled with mental illness.
That's right. I think that a partial explanation for the prevalence of the drug culture in the jazz community, particularly in, you know, the decades of the 20th century, was the fact that these men and women were literally self-medicating. And I think that the stress that was exacerbated by the fact that, you know, segregation was very prevalent in society, and here they were being lauded and adored by black and white alike and being heralded as geniuses. They get off the bandstand, they have to go around back to get out of the club. They can't stay in a hotel. They were so close but yet so far, that would drive anybody crazy.
Yeah. And so, I mean, you talked about self-medicating, and a lot of them struggled with diseases like schizophrenia. A lot of them struggled with diseases like bipolar and depression. And I think about Donny Hathaway and some of their more recent jazz greats, and they really played beautiful music. And it's such a dichotomy between the way they were able to represent and be loved out in public, and then they would go home and have these really private and very dark struggles.
That's right. You know, the old saying is there's a fine line between genius and insanity. I think that there's some truth to that, at least where music is concerned, and probably other disciplines as well.
And so talk a little bit about that genius and insanity in terms of brain. I know that you're not a neurochemist, and I'm not expecting you to be that deep, but I want you to talk a little bit about what happens with the left and the right brain and how that interconnectivity kind of interplays and causes people to kind of struggle, but yet be so brilliant.
Well, I think in a general sense, just to play music at a high level, particularly jazz, which is so much about improvisation, which is so much about taking the moment and interpreting it through music, not just playing notes on a written page that might have been written hundreds of years ago. I think in order to do that effectively, your brain has to be wired a little differently from the average person. Mm-hmm. And because of that, because we tend to be very empathic, empathetic, we tend to be very sensitive, very feeling, emotive people. I think a lot of things impact us a little differently from the way other people do.
Yeah, and one of the ways I like to kind of talk about it to lay people is that our left brain, right, is so technical and very linear in the way it processes information. And a stark contradiction to that is the right brain, which is very creative, and how the left and right brain have to really come together as an interplay and do it well in order to produce music. But there's something very special about the brain of a musician. I always say musicians and librarians. I don't get it because I never got the card catalog system.
I'm glad they did.
But it's really, really amazing. And I think that there are so many opportunities for us to now learn from those people and those musicians that struggled, because it's still such a taboo in our system to talk about mental illness, and even mental illness as it relates to music. It's still very taboo.
That's true. And when you talk about the left brain, right brain, that left brain, the analytical side, music and music theory is all numbers and it's very analytical. And what happens in jazz is you take those very analytical, numerical rules, and you basically have to completely break them down and reinterpret them. And that happens in the right brain. So your left brain and your right brain, things are going back and forth all the time. And the really greats got to a point where they just did it spontaneously, automatically.
That is amazing.
You know, then as now.
Yeah, that is amazing to me. And I wonder, I understand, like, based on the basic sense, the synaptical functions and how things interplay, but it's just amazing to me how a musician can pick up an instrument and some not ever able to read music and be able to pick it up and to play and to flow and to just go for hours. Some of you guys can.
Yeah, one place I see that a lot is in the church. I've worked with some church musicians who were just phenomenal, could take a hymn and reharmonize it and just do amazing things with it. And some of them didn't read a note of music, didn't understand one lick of theory. It was God-given.
Yeah. So, and then speaking of God-given, the kind of music that you play is, what do you call it?
Well, I refer to it as gospel jazz.
Right.
And it is the coming together of jazz and gospel. And it's kind of the sum total of my whole musical experience. I grew up listening to jazz and learning about jazz, studying jazz, but I also grew up in the church. So I was listening and learning the music of the church, particularly hymns and spirituals and a lot of the standard traditional music of church, as well as gospel. So it all kind of came together.
But you got a lot of flack, though, particularly from the church folks.
Particularly from the church folks. You gotta love church.
So you got a lot of flack from church
early
folks
on. Yes,
about
I had one experience I'll never forget. I was playing a concert for the community college where I grew up in Pittsburgh, and afterwards, you know, church folks do what they do.
They go eat.
Right. So we were at the restaurant eating, and this older lady was sitting either next to me or across from me. I think she was the first lady at some little church in Pittsburgh. And she was talking to me, and I told her at the time I was in college, I was at the University of Pittsburgh, and she asked me if I played with the gospel choir there, and I said, well, no, I don't, but I play in the jazz band. And she stopped and looked at me, and she was like, jazz? How can you play jazz and be saved?
Woo!
And, you know, I was a little militant back then.
Oh, yeah.
I started breaking her down about how if I told you if I played in the university orchestra, you wouldn't have said anything about that because you've been so brainwashed.
You and said that to a church mother.
Yeah, I did.
That's
and,
okay.
And she questioned my salvation and blah, blah, blah. So I have never forgotten that interaction. That has really stuck with me.
Has it at all shaped what you do and how you play?
I don't think it's shaped how I play so much, but I think it has shaped my expectation, if you will. You know, I know that you cannot be a spiritual baby and be ministered to through instrumental music, music without words.
Wow, say more about that.
Okay, a lot of, you know, most gospel music is vocal, and it's great. It has lyrics. But the lyrics dictate what's happening spiritually. Take me to the king. I don't have much to bring. That's a popular song recently by Tamla Mann. Everybody loves that song. But that's just one example. If you're listening to the song where you go spiritually is dictated by the lyrics. It's like a guardrail, if you will, on the road.
Yes.
But when you're listening to instrumental music,
yes,
it bypasses that conscious mind and it goes directly to a person's soul. And it takes a certain level of spiritual maturity to receive that.
Yes.
So you know, like I say, the tagline of the Washington Post, if you don't get it, you don't get it, and it's okay.
Yeah.
You know, the people who are ready to receive it, that's who I do what I do for. And the people who don't get it, that's fine.
And I'm gonna read a quote, and I want you to respond to it, from the British Journal of Psychiatry, okay? One of the really interesting and cool things about mental illness is that certain types of illnesses, mainly bipolar, gives a person a creative edge. Though other illnesses go hand in hand with highly intelligent people, such as Professor John Nash, who won the Nobel Prize for Mathematics for one, I don't think that you have to be mentally ill to be a genius, but it seems mental illness and genius do go hand in hand. And I want you to respond to that.
Okay, well, like I said, again, fine line between genius and insanity.
Yeah. Yeah.
And this is the first time I've always kind of suspected anecdotally that there was a connection between musical talent and mental, what we call mental illness,
yes,
et cetera. But that documentation is very interesting.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that one of the reasons that some artists live such kind of tortured lives is because it comes at a price. You know, when you can create all of this great music, but you have difficulty just functioning in the world on a day-to-day yeah. basis in a way that most people take for granted.
Right.
That can be very challenging.
Yes, absolutely. And so I'm going to transition a little bit to the healing. You talked about being spiritually mature enough to receive music that does not have words. So if you're listening to music that goes straight to your soul because it has no words, is that where you think the power of healing is?
Well, I think the music without words, it transcends not just the conscious mind, but I can take what I do and parenthetically, let me say that I'm about to release a song that does have vocals and lyrics. So I'm not at all opposed to vocals
right,
and lyrics. I'm
right.
just talking about the difference between the two.
Mm-hmm.
I can go somewhere where people don't speak a word of English and I don't speak a word of whatever language they speak, but they can still be communicated to because God doesn't just speak English, whether it's contemporary 21st century American English or 15th century Elizabethan English of the King James or whatever. God is not limited by language or culture or race or any of those things. God is universal. It's that aspect. And the Bible talks about the groanings of the spirit, communicating things spiritually that can't be captured by the spoken word. So I think the instrumental music that I try to play kind of taps into that.
And speaking of trying to play, you played and released your first album or CD, a meditations hymn in the keys of 8-track. You know what? Behave. 8-track. So you released a CD, and on your CD were spirituals, like hymns. And you have gotten reports of people being healed.
That's right.
I've
had people tell me that they've played the CD for relatives who were in treatment for cancer, other diseases. People have played it in labor and delivery suites, and the birth of their children.
Yes.
And that's really what it's all about for me.
Yeah,
you know, when people can take my music and use it as a tool for divine healing and the flow through of the love of God and healing, that's really in those dark times that I have when I'm like, well, what am I doing? No one is receiving this. It's those reports that really make me remember why I do what I do.
That's right. So speaking of times when you may be struggling, what do you listen to that helps you get back on balance or soothes your soul? What type of music do you listen to?
What type of music I listen to? I was traveling this past weekend And there's this whole lot of different kinds of music, but I was just hearing Mystic Voyage by Roy Ayers. And I was just hearing the song in my head over and over again. I had to stop in the airport and download the song on my phone and
so
listen to it.
So you heard it in your head?
Yeah.
You didn't hear it?
No, I hear songs in my head all the time. And matter of fact, when I'm writing, that's how I get it. A lot of times late at night, when you're in that space between waking and sleep, I'll start to hear melodies, but I have to capture them right as they're coming to me, because if I wait till morning, if I wait an hour or so, they're gone. So I have to hum them into my phone or jot them down on a piece of paper or something, and I just get little ideas and they grow into song.
What gives you inspiration to do that? Does it just happen? What happens? Because we're trying to figure out how the musician's brain works.
Yeah, like the song Meditations off my CD, the title track on the CD. The first thing I heard was, and then I started hearing more and more pieces, and the pieces just started getting stitched together, and they become songs.
Wow, wow. And that's all innate. You don't learn that. Nathan didn't teach you that, huh?
No, Nathan Davis didn't exactly teach me that. He taught me a lot about playing the saxophone, and I've learned a lot from a lot of other great musicians, but there's a part of it that is not learned. It just comes directly from God, I believe. Yeah. Oh, another example of a song. Ravel has a song called, there's a French title, but the English translation is Pavane for a Dead Princess. And for some reason, every time I hear that song, I cry like a baby.
Seriously?
Yeah.
This just in.
I can't. What? I can only listen to it at certain times. I have to put that song on, and I will just fall out.
It's called Pavane.
Pavane for a Dead. Pavane is a kind of dance. It's called Pavane for a Dead Princess.
Wow. Do you know why?
I do. Because when I was growing up, my father had an 8-track, called Ravel's Greatest Hits. And it had Bolero on it and some of the other more familiar songs of Ravel. And it had that song on it. And every time I hear that song, I think back to those days. I remember hearing it once. I hadn't heard it for years. I was out somewhere and it was playing on in a store, like the background of Muzak. And then, you know, I think back to my childhood. You know, my father's gone. My mother passed away last year. So, you know, I just think back to childhood and good times and things, and it just kind of puts me in that space.
It's kind of what Diane Reeves does to me.
Yeah.
With Grandma.
Yeah,
that Grandma song.
Days.
Yeah, Better Days.
Yeah.
So the Pavane is all instrumental.
Yes.
Wow. So talk a little bit about, you talked about your mom and your dad. What influence did they have on your music?
They had a tremendous influence. My mother dragged me to church every Sunday from my whole life.
From your whole,
and
from the
she
crib.
Was never late.
Ever.
For anything.
No.
So I was in Sunday school every Sunday.
All
and
time.
I was there in church. And the church that I grew up in, they had 3 services every Sunday. The early morning service, the 10:45 service, and then they had evening service at like 6:30 or something, and a lot of times they'd have a program in the afternoon, and they had who in the house knows about Baptist Training Union.
Oh my goodness
and
gracious.
They had Baptist Training Union at
right.
5:45, and my mother a lot of times
oh,
would be
gosh,
there for every single
gotcha.
Thing.
I can believe it.
Yeah, and I'm like, Mom, can I stay home? And you know, but I was there. Now my father, he wasn't into church, you know, but he was very much into jazz and the music. He was older guy, a World War II era guy, and he loved jazz. And Pittsburgh has a very impressive roster of jazz artists that have come out of the city, and he knew a lot of them. And he would introduce me to some of the jazz musicians who were still in Pittsburgh.
Because you played with some.
I played with some of them, Stanley Turrentine, jam session type things with people like Stanley Turrentine and George Benson, who's also from Pittsburgh, met him a couple times when he came through town, and a lot of the other musician. So, yeah.
So you had a really good time. Can you think of one of your jam sessions or someone who really had an impact on your music?
When I was about 12, I was going to this organization, this little institution called the Homer Brush and Jazz Workshop in Pittsburgh, which was started by some local Pittsburgh artists to kind of keep the jazz heritage of Pittsburgh alive. They gave lessons and they had a little big band and everything. And my teacher, Nathan Davis, had a jazz seminar every year, and he'd bring in nationally known artists. Mm-hmm. And the great saxophonist Sonny Stitt was coming through. Mm-hmm. And he came to the jazz workshop, and there was a jam session, and he played, and I played a little bit. And I barely knew who Sonny Stitt was at this time, but I can look back on that and say, wow, I got to jam with Sonny Stitt.
So how do you think that, and I bet if I were to look him up, he probably would have a mental illness. How do you think that, because a lot of the greats do, I mean, it would really blow your mind if people were to Google mental health, mental illness with jazz musicians or mental illness and artists, they would find that even the creative type that are not playing music are struggling with things like bipolar and schizophrenia. How do you find balance? Or how do you think a musician who struggles with a mental illness, struggles with family, keeping the balance with family, and then the spirituality and the whole layer of the church, what would be your recommendation for trying to really balance that all out? There's the whole piece of providing for the family and remaining spiritual and remaining true to the music. What does balance look like for a musician, a great musician?
When I figure it out, I'll let you know.
You haven't figured it out.
Some days are better than others, it can be a struggle.
Yeah.
And some people resort to the drugs, which of course is never the answer.
Right.
And some people get to a place where they can find that real place of peace.
Absolutely. And I believe strongly that the acceptance of musicians with diseases, illnesses like bipolar or schizophrenia or depression is on its way, because right now it is so taboo. For musicians to talk about, deal with the struggle, the balance between mental health and music. But I believe that it's on its way to being a lot more accepted, that eventually it might be a badge of honor.
And even in the church, I see a change. I've had a chance to attend some workshops and events where they were really talking about things like mental health and mental illness and depression. And a lot of times it was simply dismissed in past days as the devil, or you're doing something wrong, or you're not praying enough, or something like that. But now people are realizing, well, hey, if someone had a heart attack, of course we tell them to pray, but we'd also tell them to go to the doctor.
That's right.
And we're getting to a place where people in the church and in other places are starting to realize, well, hey, people need help, actual physical help. It might take the form of therapy. It might even take the form of medication for some people.
Yes.
But there's help available. And, of course, we've come such a long way in our understanding of how the brain works. And even though we know this much instead of this much, we're learning more all the time.
That's
so it's getting better.
Yeah, well, I'm going to take this opportunity, since you always play for the Lord. You never play for me. I just want about 30 seconds or something. I'll never play for B. It's always Jesus, but that's okay. Just play us out. Give us a nice tune to play us out for a few seconds.
How about some blues?
Very good. Thank you so much, Todd. That was fantastic. So what do you call that?
I don't know.
You just made that up?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought that was a tune.
That's blues.
Just the blues.
Yeah.
So it's improv.
All church, so it's going to be, hey, that boy playing blues. He's supposed to be playing blues.
But that was great. That was great. I really appreciate you coming and sharing. And I think the takeaway is that music and mental health have been wedded for the ages and will not soon part. And that there is brilliance and genius along with musical talent. And I think you said it best earlier. There's a fine line
between genius and insanity.
Woo-hoo. Thank you so much. I really appreciate
you
coming.
Thank you. It's an honor to share the stage with the inimitable Dr. Sis.
Well, thank you, Mr. Ledbetter. Yeah. Okay, very good. I would like to thank Todd for being my guest. If you would like more information about Todd and his music, visit him online at www.toddledbetter.com. If you would like more information about me, visit me on Facebook or Twitter at Dr. Sis or online at drsislena.com. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time on Healthy Mind.